scripture reading is Psalms 88, verse 1 through 9. Lord, you are the God who saves me. Day and night, I cry out to you. May my prayer come before you. Turn your ear to my cry. I am overwhelmed with troubles, and my life draws near to death. I am counted among those who go down to the pit. I am like one without strength. I am set apart with the dead, like the slain who lie in the grave, whom you remember no more, who are cut off from your care. You have put me in the lowest pit, in the darkest depths. Your wrath lies heavily on me. You have overwhelmed me with your waves. You have taken from me my closest friends and have made me repulsive to them. I am confined and I cannot escape. My eyes are dim with grief. I call to you, Lord, every day. I spread out my hands to you. This ends the reading of the scripture.
Good morning, West Henrietta Baptist Church and all our local friends and friends on social media. We are very happy to have you this morning joining us in worship. We praise God for the new day, a sunny day, and for all the blessings that will come to us today. The scripture was ably read by Valerie Bandemure, and I want to speak on the topic, holding on. The text, Psalm 88, verses 1 to 9. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. We praise you, we adore you this morning, O God, for your mighty acts, for your wonderful deeds, for waking us up this morning. And we are so thankful. Bless this word now to our hearts, for we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Have you ever had a dark, dismal, and/or disappointing day? We often talk about having the joy of the Lord and walking in the sunshine of God's countenance. However, there are days when it is difficult to rejoice. And I praise God this morning for everyone who have reason to rejoice, or no reason at all, who may just say, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And somebody say amen. But have you had one of these difficult, dismal, and dark days? A day when you felt small, or you felt insulted by a negative comment from someone that completely derailed an otherwise happy day? Or you feel like a bad parent. Or you feel like a bad spouse. Or you had some big problems. Or you're feeling ill. Or you experience a bad everything. Or perhaps just a bad mood for absolutely no reason. You will agree that a bad day is something that holds you back from seeing anything bright about it. The author of Psalm 88 tells us about some difficult days he had. Listen, Lord, you are the God who saves me. Day and night I cry out to you. May my prayer come before you. Turn your ear to my cry. I am overwhelmed with trouble, and my life draws near to death. I am counted among those who go down the pit. I am like one without strength. Psalm 88, the first four verses. Allow me to identify and develop three aspects of the psalmist's experience. The first is pleading for God's help. So pleading for God's help. Note that the psalmist is struggling with unanswered prayers. Oh Lord, God of my salvation, I have cried out day and night before you. Let my prayer come before you. Incline your ear to my cry. This is not an unsaved man crying out to a God he doesn't worship. This is a true believer pleading with God for help, pleading with God to answer his prayers. He has been praying for a while. And it seemed to him that God hasn't answered his prayers. Some of us might be in that situation this morning. But let me hasten to say that delayed answers to prayers are not a recent phenomenon. They have a history as long as Abraham got acquainted with God, and they are featured in the journey of the prayer giants. Knowing this doesn't make unanswered prayers easier to accept. But there is a grace for dealing with the disappointment. What happens to you when there is no sign of an answer to your prayers? Yes, the disappointment can trigger a range of emotions, from quiet grief to loud anger, from numbness to the frenzy of producing an answer of our own. Muting our feelings can be as harmful as venting them carelessly. Like the psalmist, we need to learn to complain to the Lord without violating trust in him. This approach, my brothers and sisters, can be deeply therapeutic for our feelings associated with unanswered prayers. Get this. Honest lament is different from harmful grumbling. The grumbler blames God for the disappointments. The grumbler blames God for his failures. The grumbler blames God for his or her sickness. Whereas the honest lament unpacks the feelings of grief, anger, frustration, fear, confusion, despair, rejection, anxiety, and hope without accusing the Lord God himself of doing anything wrong or neglecting his duties. And so my word of encouragement this morning to those who are dealing with unanswered prayers is to hold on. Hold on. Trust God. Why? Because prayers can be hard at times. And so many people pray. And for whatever reason or not, they do not believe what they are praying for. They do not believe that there is an answer to the prayer, or there is going to be an answer to their prayers. Without faith, it would be difficult for many of us to get through many difficult situations. In times of stress or the intensity of our problems, it is natural to look for the answers or reasoning behind what is happening in our lives. Is it that God is not interested? Is it that God is not listening? Through prayer, God gives us a way to talk to Him. No matter what we're going through, God wants to be there for us and help us through whatever is on our minds. Hold on. Keep praying. Be more persistent in your prayer. God comes through on time. God is never late. The second thing I want to point out in the text is resilience in the face of trouble and sickness. It seems like the psalmist was coping with trouble and sickness. Listen, for my soul is full of troubles, and my life draws near to the grave. I'm counted with those who go down to the pit. I am like a man who has no strength. You have put away my acquaintances far from me. You have made me an abomination to them. I am confined and I cannot get out. Verses 3, 4, and 8. Some scholars think that the psalmist had leprosy. In fact, it's not believed that the psalmist was David. This is believed to be a psalmist who had leprosy, since he said he was segregated from everyone else. Leprosy comes to mind with that kind of life situation. One thinks a person has leprosy tells or brings that person to the priest. And the priests are the only ones who can determine one to be a leper. The priest may notice the signs appearing in one and further evaluate. Once discovered, the priest declares the person unclean, and then the person is now deemed a leper and is then put out from the community. Let's consider the persons this morning who are coping with illnesses that alienated them from others and or from us. Coping with sickness that alienates one. Let's think about others this morning whose chronic illness renders them physically confined to their homes. Let's consider those persons who are coping with troubles, coping with sickness and loneliness. You see, the feeling of loneliness is painful emotionally and can have a devastating impact on both physiological and psychological health, including increased risk of depression, decreased immune system function, and stress to the cardiovascular system, just to think about a few. And so the psalmist tells us that his soul is full of trouble. He was sick. He was lonely. He felt like he was dying and very close to the grave. My soul is full of trouble. He sees himself as being close to death, with no way of being rescued. Knowing that death is not far away takes an emotional toll on the psalmist. And like anyone else dealing with death or impending death, takes an emotional toll on that person and loved ones. Some persons might feel shock, and some may feel fear. They might feel guilty about being a burden, or worry about how their death will affect loved ones left behind. It was natural for the psalmist to feel intense grief during this stage of his life. He had already lost things, such as strength to get around like he used to. He says, "I feel like a man without strength." Anybody feels that way this morning? Going through a time of sickness? Or he might have lost interest in doing the things he once enjoyed. And surely he was not able to get together with friends. He was alienated, probably with leprosy. He probably was grieving the loss of the life he planned and the life he expected. And so this morning, somebody might be going through the experience of the psalmist. You might have recently received or coping with a diagnosis of cancer or heart disease or diabetes or any other serious illnesses. No doubt, life changes when you learn that you have a life-threatening illness. Perhaps you cried. Perhaps you sought out the comfort of a loved one. Or you did your best to distract yourself or pretend like nothing had changed. Or maybe you simply froze, unable to process how your life had suddenly changed. Or perhaps you even jumped in action and started tackling your own health problems head on. Question this morning is, how is your journey going on with problems of life or sickness? How is the journey? How is the journey through your illness? How is your faith journey, your trust in God, your confidence in God, you have been holding on for a while. Hold on yet longer. I challenge, I charge, and I encourage you to hold on. Faith in God matters. God is present with you in every situation. Jesus says, I will not leave you or forsake you. And the words of the song come to mind. Through days of toil, when heart does fail, God will take care of you. When dangers fierce your path assail, God will take care of you. So those of us who are struggling this morning, you're out there, you're somewhere and you're struggling this morning with trouble, family trouble, whatever the trouble is, personal trouble, whatever it is, you're trying to cope. Hold on. Trust in God, and He will take care of you. And my third point, it comes from the text. I see hope amidst desolation. Hear the text. I'm counted among those who go down to the pit. I'm counted among those who go down to the grave. I am like one without strength. I am set apart with the dead. Like the slain who lie in the grave. When you remember whom you remember no more, who are cut off from your care. Do you feel what the psalmist is? Desolation? How sad he seems to feel. You see, the foundation of the psalmist's life seems to be slipping away. Slipping away. And the possibility of death looms before him. In his desolation, he holds on to God's power. He holds on to God's loving kindness and God's faithfulness. This is not a time to lose trust in God. This is not the time to lose hope in God when you are in a desolate place. We learn from the psalmist that whenever he experienced a difficult day, he would reach out to God, he would cry unto God, and we need to encourage ourselves when we are in such situation by focusing on God's character and God's attributes, meaning the power of God, His loving kindness and faithfulness. Remember what God has done for us in the past. See, we have a tendency to trust circumstances or trust ourselves, or trust other people. But the psalmist tends to differ. He said, I'm going to trust God alone. I'm going to trust the Lord of my salvation. In whom I trust. Where does hope come from? Scripture tells us where to look for hope. Too often we look in all the wrong places. The Bible is filled with the persistent belief that despite the trauma and tragedies of life, God is still working his purpose out in our lives. The message of the Bible is that there is no situation that is without hope. And so, regardless of what you may be going through this morning, it does not matter what it is. It doesn't matter how dark it looks. It doesn't matter how dismal it looks. It doesn't matter how disappointing the situation may be or desperate it may be. There is hope in God. We have just celebrated resurrection of Jesus. It gives hope. He came from the dead, having been crucified and buried, he rose from the grave, and three powerful words declared by the angel to the ladies who went to see Jesus' body: he is risen. Never before such words were expressed. He is risen. Hallelujah. He is risen. There is hope. You see, you can trust the power that raised Jesus from the dead. You can trust the power of Christ Jesus to bring you through whatever it is you face or will face. The Bible reveals that your heavenly Father is the God of hope, the one who wants to fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. When I started the sermon this morning, you may be in despair. You may be experiencing the blues, dark times and difficult times, desolate times, disappointing times. But I want to end this sermon with a challenge that you need not remain in that state of mind. As you draw near to God this morning in prayer, your hope will be nurtured. As God rekindles your hope, it will become the breeding ground of your faith. Faith in God can turn your difficult situations around, and you may be able to shout this morning that God is real, shout that God is a way maker, shout that God is a deliverer, because he has made a way for you, and because he has delivered you, and because he has saved you. Hold on! Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath the wings of love abide, God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean, weary ones, upon his breast, God will take care of you. And the chorus says, God will take care of you through every day, over all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. That's why my challenge this morning ought to be received and accepted. Hold on. Hold on to faith. God will strengthen that faith and will turn your dark, your dismal, your disappointing and desolate days into his glorious sunshine, into new day, into a brand new day. Amen. And amen. Keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace now and always. Amen.